Thank you very, very much for the introduction and to be here with you this afternoon to share with you our experiences in transdisciplinary research at the University of Stellenbosch, a path, as the introduction already mentioned, started way back in 2005. So thank you to the university, to IAT, and to the Faculty of Education for this wonderful opportunity to be here with you this afternoon. So the way that I would like to structure my short presentation is then as follows, is to talk about our understanding of transdisciplinarity in the context of, or in the time of, or at the time of, the Anthropocene. It's important for us to talk about transdisciplinarity not in abstract, as just a theoretical concept, but actually within a particular context. And the context for us, for example, is that of the Anthropocene. Then I would like to share with you the history of transdisciplinarity as we have pathed it, as we have journeyed it over the last 10 years since 2005. Because this is a particular path that we have walked at Stellenbosch University. And from our discussion already yesterday at IAT, it is already clear that you've walked a different path. You've traversed a different path to our path. And therein lies, I think, the possibilities of a rich dialogue to understand how we've walked different paths and where are we at now and how can we actually enter into a more institutional dialogue with each other to see how we can enrich each other's not only understanding of transdisciplinary research in the Anthropocene, but also how can we set up research projects, hopefully, and other institutional ways of collaborating further into the future. Then I would like to say a few words and make a presentation on a particular case study that we have embarked upon since 2011. We've learned a heck of a lot of how to embark on a real-life, real-world case study called Inkanini. And the word Inkanini is a Xhosa word which means taken by force. It's a case study that I think you would respond well to, because we call it slums or informal settlements in South Africa, and I think you call it favelas here in Brazil. And this has been our social laboratory of experience, where we have gained a lot of experience in how to conduct transdisciplinary research, and I will share that with you. And then hopefully there will be sufficient time for me to then stop, and then we can actually open up for discussion. And that's what I'm really interested in, is to find out, what do you think, how do you respond, how do you critique what I've presented here, so that we can, as I said, move on in a more constructive way to dialogue with each other. Charles, are you okay? I'm not speaking too fast. Good. So, when we talk about transdisciplinarity, as I said, it is important to do this within a particular context. At least this is our understanding of how to go about it. When we talk about the Anthropocene, we have to ask ourselves some questions. Are we producing thought leaders that are capable of having the capacity and the capabilities of not only understanding the Anthropocene that we're living in today, but that can also actually conduct research that can help to change the societies that we are living in? A second question is, not only do we produce the thought leaders for the future, but also are we building research institutions with the necessary institutional capabilities and capacity to respond to the Anthropocene? A third question is, are we producing or are we learning how to co-produce knowledge and relevant knowledge to transform the conditions that are producing the Anthropocene, that are capable of contributing to social change, in short? A fourth question is, are we designing and using new research methodologies and methods capable of crossing the disciplinary divide, or are we still locked into the monodisciplinary paradigm? And just the last question, are we doing, or are we rather developing, relevant research programs and projects that are context sensitive, that can respond to the Anthropocene, that can help us to understand how to go about changing the world that we're living in, called the Anthropocene? These are just a few questions that will hopefully spark our debate in and around what it is that we mean by transpersonality. And I come back to that in a slide or two. But just to say that, what is it that we mean when we talk about the Anthropocene? In 2002, Paul Crutzen, the Nobel Peace Laureate, for chemistry, published this two-page article in which he announced that we are now living in the Anthropocene. And he said that this means that we are, as humans, we've become the equivalent of a geological factor on the Earth. If we think of the impact that we are having on Earth's system or Earth systems, causing planetary scale problems, such as climate change, the ozone hole, acid rain, ocean acidification, soil depletion, and so on and so forth. But the important thing here is that these problems are happening at a planetary scale, something that we have never, ever, as a human species, actually experienced before. And this paper of his, the two-pager, has found its way in many, many, as you will probably know, in many, many different literatures, and it's gaining a lot of traction, emphasizing and re-emphasizing basically the fundamental point of the human impact at a planetary scale on the Earth systems. It also provides us with a context, a planetary context, to talk about the Sustainable Development Goals that have just been adopted recently. When we talk about these goals, we cannot just talk about them in abstract, because each of those 17 goals are actually in some way or another relating back to the problems that we are experiencing at the planetary scale in the Anthropocene. Our problem, of course, is that we are sitting with a dominant worldview, a scientific worldview of the two worlds, nature and society, and the disciplinary divide that comes with that, as two different realities, ontologically speaking, two different worlds. One is nature that is meant for the natural sciences, and the other one is society that is meant for the social sciences. And this has been a dominant paradigm since René Descartes in the 1700s. Not only is this a paradigm, a way of thinking, but what we have done is that we've actually gone about and structured universities along these lines. And this just happens to be our university with its 10 different faculties: science, social science, agri-sciences, economics, health sciences, education, theology, engineering, law, and military science, all calling themselves sciences. But within those pillars, we have also not just institutionalized, but we've actually put into concrete the way that universities operate. And it is hardly ever seen or experienced that academics would move across these silos or these pillars in the way that we have structured and institutionalized universities. So our challenge is, coming back to the Anthropocene, that we have to adopt a whole new way of thinking, of understanding the interconnectedness and the complexity of the world that we're living in. I think that the famous saying of Einstein, that we cannot solve problems with the same mindsets that have actually created the problems. We have to adopt and develop a new way of thinking about the world. And there are many books that have appeared around, and I'm just mentioning one here, around the art of interconnected thinking, as the one that I'm sharing with you here by Friedrich Fester from Germany. Because in the Anthropocene, we are seeing that nature and society are beginning to merge. They are not, as we have thought for many, many years, two different realities, two different worlds. And in the middle space where science is finding itself increasingly are these complex and connected planetary scale problems, such as climate change, soil depletion, poverty, energy, food, natural resources, water, biodiversity, and so on. And it is in this space that I think that transdisciplinarity has emerged as a particular methodology, a particular way of doing research. It is in this space where we are dealing with these planetary scale problems that can no longer be separated as nature and society that the transdisciplinary research game is starting, and that it is wanting to play in this space. So when we then come back to the more theoretical level and ask, what is transdisciplinarity? We can, of course, say that it's not a new baby anymore. It is something that has been written about over the last two decades quite extensively. And I'm just sharing with you some of the books. This is not a complete list, but some of the books that have appeared since Piaget and Erich Jansch for the first time wrote about and mentioned the word transdisciplinarity in 1972. But of course, when we say and when we use a concept like transdisciplinarity, we have to also then distinguish it from other modes of knowledge production, such as monodisciplinarity, multidisciplinarity, interdisciplinarity, and then, of course, transdisciplinarity. But just a guideline that when we go down this route of wanting to distinguish transdisciplinarity with these other modes of knowledge production, that we shouldn't go into this with the idea that transdisciplinarity is a higher form of knowledge production or that it is better as the other ones. As Basarab Niculescu is saying here, is that basically these four different modes of knowledge production should be seen or imagined as arrows all shot from the same single bow, which is knowledge. And therein lies the principle that we should treat them all as equally important. So when we talk about or refer to monodisciplinarity, basically what this means is that problem definition happens within individual disciplines, and they will study different issues or real-world problems or problem fields without consulting each other. Neither will they consult with any societal actors. Also, the problem statements will lead then within a particular discipline to research questions and also the choice of methods. And again, there is no contact and no interaction with any other disciplines. When we talk about multidisciplinarity, the game changes a little bit in the sense that you will have different disciplines now looking at the same problem, but they will still define the problem, they will still define the research questions, and they will still decide on the methods separately, although they're working on the same issues, real-world issues. In interdisciplinarity, the game changes again, in a sense that the disciplines that are now collaborating with each other on the same problems are now beginning to exchange information and methods of doing research. They will consult each other in terms of how do we understand the problem that we are working on, and what are the research questions we should be asking, and what are the research methods that we should be using. But this exchange will always happen from the base discipline's point of view. You would ask another discipline, how do you understand the problem, what are the methods that you're using in order to enrich yourself, your own discipline, at the end of the day. But when we move to transdisciplinarity, the ball game changes quite significantly yet again, in the sense that we start radically with the complex problems that are not completely and fully knowable. Neither can we model them completely with all our clever modeling tools and techniques that we have developed. It's not in the beginning clear when you work with complex socio-ecological systems problems exactly what are the disciplines that are needed. Neither does one know what and who are the social actors that you actually have to engage with. All of the above, the disciplines and the social actors that need to come around the table, so to speak, have to be figured out as you go along. And therein lies the difference, is the problem definition is what we call joint problem definition. That needs to happen not only between the different disciplines, but also in consultation with social actors. What is it that they practically know about the problems that we're dealing with, and what are their solutions that they may come up with? We can also say then, and this is quite an important point, that transdisciplinarity is an emerging new methodology of doing science with society. Rather than purporting to be a new science per se, of doing science on or about or for society. By changing the preposition to with society lies the big difference of what it is that we doing that when we are having to do transdisciplinary research. And in order to do science with society, transdisciplinarity is collaborative. It's about knowledge co-production, not only between the natural and social sciences, but also by actively involving the social actors. So it's about double boundary crossing. Transdisciplinarity is also transformative. It is explicitly solution-oriented. It wants to look and find solutions, integrated, practical, sustainable solutions to the problems that we are dealing with. It is therefore interested in wanting to co-produce useful knowledge that are socially useful. A third characteristic of transdisciplinarity is that it is integrative. It is always looking at how can we integrate knowledge from across the different disciplines, the natural and social sciences, but also how can we integrate practical, tacit, experiential knowledge so that we not only better understand the problems that we're dealing with, but also in terms of finding integrated solutions. It is also innovative. Transdisciplinarity is also innovative in the sense that it is keenly interested in wanting to understand the problems, the societal challenges that we're working with in new ways. It is interested in theory building. And it is interested in doing that by co-producing three different types of knowledge. Systems knowledge, that is of what is, what is the current reality is, like factual knowledge, but also target knowledge of what should be, not only of what is, but also what it is that we want or move towards, normative knowledge. And thirdly, it's also keenly interested in co-producing transformative knowledge. And that is, how do we transition from where we are to where we would like to be? And we can call that strategic knowledge. And a last important characteristic of transdisciplinarity is that it is egalitarian. It treats all knowledge, both theoretical and practical knowledge, as of equal value. When we stand in front of the complex problems of society and nature and the environment that we have to solve, both theoretical and practical knowledge is of equal value to try and find solutions. It's not as if theory and scientific knowledge is higher or better than practical knowledge. In fact, we need practical, tacit, experiential knowledge to help us find those integrated solutions. And here is just a picture of what an ideal typical model of a joint or a collaborative transdisciplinary research process of science with society can look like, may look like. Remember, all models are good and some are worse than others. This is just a construction taken from the literature, and you can see again science and society coming together, and in the middle there is at least a four-phased process, starting with preparing and designing the research process, moving on to joint problem framing, what is the problem that you're working on, engaging the social actors in this process as well, of course, and then how do we come up with strategies to change in the third phase? How do we come up with strategies to change the problems that we're working on? And then finally, how do we bring the results to fruition in terms of publications and getting dissertations and so on? You will see that I've got steps included in these different phases, four phases. We can talk more about that if you're interested in during our question time. So let me then just quickly move over to our short history of transdisciplinarity at Stellenbosch University, which, as you've already heard, started way back in 2005. In 2005, as you've already mentioned, we had a first transdisciplinary workshop where we invited academics from other universities in Stellenbosch, and our drawing plaster or our attractors were these two well-known theoreticians, Basarab Nicolescu and Mansur Maksniev, who came and brainstormed with us what it is that we should understand under transdisciplinarity and what it is that we can do with it. The outcome of that particular workshop was the following. We firstly realized that we needed to establish a particular institute, an inter-faculty research center that can work across different faculties and disciplines and departments to bring together academics interested in the transdisciplinary methodology. Just like you've had the need here to come up with EAT, so we have also done that. We have formed strategic partnerships or relationships, in our case with 7 different faculties: economics, science, engineering, agri-sciences, education, arts and social sciences, and even theology. We have also struck strategic relationships with the CSIR, with the HSRC in South Africa, and also with a very important NGO, the Sustainability Institute. All of these institutions play a critically important role in how we go about doing and practicing transdisciplinarity at Stellenbosch University. We have also, over the years, managed to establish, and I'll explain in a moment to why this is so important, a panel of supervisors made up of the natural sciences, the social sciences, and engineering that can help with the co-supervision of doctoral students. We have also implemented in 2010 a transdisciplinary doctoral program in sustainability or sustainable development. And we decided to do that not as a program in transdisciplinarity per se, but to do it in sustainability. We've conducted a number of summer and winter schools. And as I said, we've also conducted a case study since 2011. And I will go over now to explain a bit more about each of these aspects that we have covered and worked in over the last couple of years. The transdisciplinary doctoral program started in 2010, and the focus areas of this particular doctoral program is, as you can see there, on the sustainability challenges facing the African continent today, such as poverty, food, water, energy, waste, biodiversity, urbanization, and so on, all in the face of climate change. And this is quite important. We're not taking a explicitly climate change as the big elephant in the room approach, but we are arguing that these other issues all should be conceptualized as important in and of themselves and should not be dominated by the big climate change debate. Because in Africa, we are still struggling with poverty, huge levels of structural poverty, food security, water security, energy security are huge issues on the African continent. And we have to think of solving those problems or finding solutions to those problems in the face of climate change. This doctoral program is a full-time 3-year program. And we've decided strategically to do this within the existing PhD structure within the university. In other words, if you're a PhD student, you come in and you still have to be registered in a particular home faculty and department. And your research PhD proposals still have to go through exactly the same procedures and processes as any other PhD student. The reason for this strategic decision was that we didn't want to be seen as posing a threat to the existing faculty systems and structures. We rather thought it will be strategically better and wiser to work within the system rather than setting up a whole new degree, PhD degree from scratch. As I already mentioned, the co-supervision of the students by a panel of supervisors is critically important. The core modules that we present during this PhD program are 3 at least, and they are non-credit bearing modules. The theory and methodology of transdisciplinarity is one module. The next one is complexity theory. And then we also have another module in sustainable development and sustainability. These are just modules that we have thought are relevant for PhD students that would like to follow this particular program. It's not the end or the sum total. We can, of course, expand on this. There's another module on for example, systems dynamic modeling that that have come forward that many students are doing. So we can add to these particular modules as we go along. But for the moment, those are the ones that we feel are quite important for PhD students to go through. We also, another component of the doctoral program is our two-weekly PhD seminars, where the students would come together every Friday afternoon, and they would present their work and discuss their work and critique it. And if we're lucky, some of the busy supervisors will actually attend these two-weekly meetings as well. And this is critically exciting and important to have these regular meetings. And of course, lastly, there's the ongoing individual contact sessions between the PhD student and his or her supervisors or co-supervisors. These are just some of the components of the PhD program. And then just to give you an indication, here's one student, a PhD student who's already graduated, I'm glad to say, from the PhD program, Sydney Mufungenhama from Zimbabwe. And he's interested in the role of wild vegetables in food security in the African context. And he has just a paper that he's already published in this regard. And what his co-supervisory team look like is that his main supervisor is Dr. Willem de Klerk from the Agri-Sciences Faculty and the Soil Science Department. And then co-supervisor is Professor Miller McLachlan from the Health Sciences Faculty and the Human Nutrition Department. And then a third co-supervisor, Professor Mark Swilling, who's from the Economics Faculty and from the School or Department of Public Leadership. So this is an interdisciplinary co-supervisory team of those, the panel of supervisors that we have assembled around this particular student. And this is what we're trying to achieve in the PhD program. What we've also done quite successfully over the last 10 years is that we have managed to conduct two European Union funded programs, the Intra-ACP Mobility Scheme, and which we call in short TREK Africa. And basically what this scheme is all about is that it is basically like an Erasmus Mundus program, mobility scheme program for Africa. And we've chosen, when we applied for this particular funding proposal, we applied for it with an explicit research focus on, again, the sustainability challenges facing Africa. We were twice successful with these two programs. In 2012, we got 2.4 million euros, and 2015, 2.3 million euros. And we brought together six African universities. You can see them there, Ethiopia, Ghana, Nigeria, Tanzania, Kenya, and Botswana. And the important thing there is that Stellenbosch University is the coordinating university of this consortium. We've got an excellent international office, just like yourselves, I believe, that are very, very skilled in knowing how to institutionalize these consortia. So I think this is a very important point if we would think between our universities of how to take our relationship forward. We've got the capacity, institutional capacity at our university to conduct and manage very, very successfully such consortia. This particular, or these two programs taken together have involved 104 master students from those six universities, 54 PhD students, and also it includes staff exchange. There's money for that for staff to be exchanged to visit the universities for periods of time, 3 months, 6 months, or whatever. So just to say that from our small beginnings in 2005 to where we are now, we've managed to accumulate, to generate quite a bit of research funding for funding our transdisciplinary research activities. The summer and winter schools, just a short few notes on this. There's an advertisement that we put in the local papers to advertise for it. We've had 10 summer and winter schools so far. The participants that come to these summer and winter schools are our prospective master's and PhD students, as well as current PhD students. And also, very importantly, supervisors and academics. This has been one of the unintended consequences when we started the summer and winter schools, that we saw that there were academics that became very interested in these summer and winter schools and what it is that they can come and learn with students in terms of how to do transdisciplinary research. And here are just some pictures, if you can see that, of some of the winter schools that we've had. And the areas that we will cover typically during these summer and winter schools are the differences between mono, inter, and transdisciplinarity, how to do joint problem framing of the complex problems that we're dealing with formal stakeholders as well as with informal social actors, how to formulate problem statements and research questions that may contribute to practical problem solutions as well as to new theoretical knowledge of social change, how to integrate knowledge from the different disciplines and social knowledge systems, how to design transdisciplinary research processes, both individually or for individual as well as large-scale projects, and lastly, how do we choose and use appropriate research methods for doing transdisciplinary research? And when we talk about methods, we use it in an interesting way. We talk about methoding as a verb and not as a noun. It's what we have to do. What are the practical steps that we need to do to be practicing in order to do transdisciplinary research? As I mentioned, we engaged in 2011 with this particular case study, a transdisciplinary case study, and by that I mean an intentional transdisciplinary research approach. Inkanini, as I said, the name means taken by force, and basically it is this informal settlement that is just 2 kilometers away from Stellenbosch University, on our doorstep, so to speak. And it's basically this group of people that moved from Kayamandi to the southwest and just occupied illegally a piece of land because they could no longer stay in this Kayamandi as backyard dwellers. And what is important about our experiences is that we've had to learn how to work in an emergent context, where how to go about doing transdisciplinary research was not all that clear when we started. The background to this is that in 2004, our government announced a new policy on incremental upgrading, but it was only just a policy that was announced. There was no practical experience of how to actually do incremental upgrading in the South African context. And our first question was, in this emerging context, working with a group or a community, we even questioned whether we can use the word community because they were so new, the people that have just arrived in that in Kanini area, was how do we go about setting up a transdisciplinary case study if there are no legitimized stakeholders with whom we can talk, who we can have workshops with? How do we go about doing that? A second question was, what is the problem statement exactly when we deal with such an emerging community? When we know that they have to wait up to 10 years before the government will arrive with its grid solutions, big housing projects, infrastructure on water, sanitation, and waste. None of that was available, is still available. And we know on average in South Africa, poor people living in slums have to wait up until 10 years. So what is the problem statement when we know this from the context? So we formulated our guiding problem statement. It's an overarching guiding problem statement. Is what is it that we can do in the present whilst we're waiting? Not what we're going to do in 10 years' time, but what is it that we can do now or tomorrow or next month? There's a nice phrase that captures this as well, is to discover the evolutionary potential of the present. What is it that we can achieve in the here and the now? And a guiding research question following from that problem statement is, how can we co-produce with people living in shacks in Inkanini transformative knowledge in the present that can empower them so that they can actually improve their own situation? And the emerging transdisciplinary research process happened something like this. Our students went in not knowing exactly what methods of research they're going to use, and they saw that the people were painting their shacks, and they offered, can we help you to come and paint the shacks? And of course, the people were too keen. What then happened from that was that they were invited to come and stay over in the shacks. First for a cup of coffee or some tea, and later on to stay over for weekends. And as you can see there, there's a particular researcher sitting there, listening to the narratives, to the stories of people telling their experiences, starting to share their experiences of what it means to live in a slum. That gave rise to that student coming up with a brilliant idea of using his knowledge that he's built up in the master's degree in sustainable development, particularly the ecological design course that he's undergone, to actually redesign a shack, what it should look like. And that process involved an architect, economists, engineers, anthropologists, sitting around this interesting challenge of how can we actually better shacks from what they are to make life a little bit more comfortable whilst we're waiting for the government to come with their housing strategy and structures. The next phase was then all about co-constructing and implementing and building new shacks, which is called the iShack, improved shack, which involved putting up solar panels on the roof, making it possible for people to have access to DC, direct current electricity. And it then involves people moving in and starting to live in these iShacks. And as we speak, there are now more or less 1,000 shacks connected to their own energy mini-grid system. All of this happened in the absence of the state. There was no state officials involved in this process so far. So here's a little mini-grid that poor people are paying for and maintaining on their own without the help or the assistance of the state. Remember, our overall problem statement and research question was, what is it that we have to do in the present whilst we're waiting? And this is what has been achieved. We've learned a lot, practically. We've learned a lot about what it means to build or redesign shacks, their north-northeast face orientation to help with the temperature regulation, as well as the kind of building materials that needs to be used. Implementing over or designing them with overhangs, building their back walls from cob or clay bricks, as well as using cardboard boxes or Tetra Pak throwaway materials as insulation. And we've also learned a lot about how to install, as I mentioned earlier, direct current, photovoltaic microgrid systems in these and on the roofs of these systems. But this is not just about technology. It's also about, the question was, what about the maintenance and the payment of these new iShacks? Who will pay for them and who will maintain them? And that involved a lot of discussions, and this is the institutional and social aspect of the innovation that we achieved, to make it possible for shacks, for individual shack dwellers to live in these redesigned shacks and to pay for them. And a few people then put their hands up and said, okay, here's a job opportunity. We will become the maintenance people, and created new jobs. Entrepreneurship opportunities came forward. We've also learned not just a lot of practical issues, but also a lot of theoretical learning points emerge out of this case study experience, such as that when we talk about the transdisciplinary methodology, that it is guided for us, in our thinking at least, by a triple logic. The transformative logic, which means involving explicitly, or rather intervening explicitly, in the messiness of the complex real-life situations in order to bring about social change, which is more just and more sustainable than the current situation. So there's an explicit normative element in transdisciplinary research. What does it mean to work towards a situation that is more just and more sustainable? Of course, nobody really knows. It's something that has to be sorted out and figured out. And for that, we call the abductive logic. of going with one's intuition or your hunches of what it is that could be better, it could be more sustainable, it could be more just or more equitable. And thirdly, a third logic is the integrative logic of looking continuously for integrating perspectives, experiences that seem to be contradictory or conflicting, working with conflicting and contradictory experiences. Basarab Niculescu, in his book, The Manifesto, calls this the logic of the included middle versus the logic of the excluded middle. Some of the guiding principles that have come out of our research experience is, firstly, to perturb the system. When you do transdisciplinary research, it's about what my colleague, Professor Mark Swilling, calls social acupuncture. You have to prod, you have to make some incisions in the system to see what it is that one can do and learn from that to change the system, perturbing the system. A second guiding principle is that of acceptation. What we've learned is to use products or materials lying at hand, not only for their intended purposes, but also to use them for other purposes, such as in the iShack. Throwaway materials can actually be used in new ways when you think about redesigning the iShack. But it's not only about objects and things, practical things, but also in terms of methods. As I mentioned, when the students went in, they started to listen to the stories, the narratives of the people in the shacks. And that idea of how we can use narrative theory became an interesting point for us. We started reflecting on that. And when I go back next month, we will conduct a second week of our winter school, specifically focusing on narrative theory and narrative approaches, and how that can help us to do joint problem framing in a creative way. And it is out of this experience of the Inkanini case study that this particular method arose, and that we're now actually delving deeper and deeper into. Multi-loop transformative learning. This is absolutely critical. There's a level one technical level of learning, which is all about acquiring new practical knowledge and skills. And then there's a level two social learning, mutual learning, of how to share this technical knowledge and skills that you've built up. But the level three learning is what is really important, which Gregory Bateson refers to as transformative learning. This is where you learn about learning. And I think from an education faculty point of view, this could be quite interesting, is when you learn the learning of learning, that you can start figuring out how to start changing the learning process and start to move towards social change. What we've also learned is to allow for emergence. When we're working in a context that is forever changing, it is important to allow new ideas and new challenges to emerge and arise out of the context, and that one should be open to actually allow those challenges to become new research questions that need to be further researched. And for that, one needs, again, new creative methods to do that. And then very lastly, a final fifth guiding principle is to absorb complexity. What this means practically in our context was, other than the way that transdisciplinarity has been written up from Switzerland and Germany, is that we cannot try to reduce the complexity of the real-life situation that we're working with. When we move in a slum area, we are essentially working with fundamental unequal knowledge power relationships. And you have to work with that, and you have to know how to negotiate your way through and around these unequal relationships. And you have to figure out how to work with that, and rather than trying to pretend or trying to set up discussion processes that exclude these power differences. So just to say lastly that these learning principles of the guiding logics and principles of doing transdisciplinary research in an emerging context. I'm busy writing this up with my friend and colleague Mark Swilling, and we're about to submit this to the Sustainability Science Journal. So just to let you know that from our practical experience in this particular context, we've learned a lot theoretically, and we're also using this opportunity to plow this back into the body of literature on transdisciplinarity. So I thank you very much for your attention. I'm not sure how much I went over my time, but now we can hopefully open up for discussion or after you've made your presentation.